Hello and welcome back to another reasoning session, and this is more of a foundation building, playing with puzzles kind of a session to build basic comfort. We've already done a lot of CAT problems. Also connect this kind of thinking, this basic level thinking, with our exam problems. I want to repeat this point over and over again, that each of the puzzles that I'm trying from this particular book, from the George Summers Basic Puzzles book, I see a lot of similarity between those and the exam questions, except the scale is different. For example, in this puzzle, we'll see we have three conditions to work with. In an exam story, there might be, in a difficult set, there might be 5 or 8 or 9 conditions to work with. So the scale differs, but that unit of thought or the approach of thought remains exactly the same. So I had promised earlier that if anybody sends me a photo of the book along with their own face, I will do one puzzle for each person. So some people did send me photos, so in the same journey I am going puzzle by puzzle. This one is called The Visit. It's from page number 27 from this particular book. I have already spoken about this book in another video. I hope you go through that and invest in this book or a similar book like this, right? So let me straight away dive into the puzzle, and once again, not only I want to solve the puzzle, that will not be too much of a challenge. I want to notice that what is this process that I'm using? What are the tools that I'm using to figure things out? So you will see basic deductive reasoning, keeping the rules in mind and following those rules. You can't break the rule. That is your essential game. And you will see that the story gives you many possibilities. The rules will help you eliminate those possibilities. Once again, all of this is theory. It makes way more sense as we try it out. But as we try it out, do notice, use a part of your brain to observe the process, not just the solution. I hope you see the distinction. So the story was quite straightforward. Four people, A, B, C, and D, visited Edna, or E. A visited Edna at 8 o'clock, B at 9 o'clock, C at 10 o'clock, D at 11 o'clock, and it all happened in a single day on a Saturday. Now, at the surface itself, if you're used to such puzzles, there is a problem. I do not know whether it's 8 o'clock in the morning or 8 o'clock in the evening. I do not know whether it's AM in the morning or PM in the evening. So that is a problem. And in case you thought it was 8 AM, 9 AM, 10 AM and 11 AM, one, you're very, very innocent and naive. Second was, if you read the rules, you would have figured out that, okay, there's a problem in the story, and that problem can only be fixed by putting the AM PM part of the story together. Now I have captured the information, I am going for the rule, and I will see what that rule is telling me, what are the possibilities that are created. Then I will use another rule, add the two rules together, and some possibilities will be eliminated. Repeat the process. One rule will give you some possibilities. Another rule added to the previous rule will help you eliminate possibilities. So that is the process, right? So the first rule was, at least one woman visited Edna between Alma and Bess. So for a minute, I'm going to create a lot of scenarios, and you should do it with me. Alma and Bess, if they came at 8 a.m. and 9 a.m., can there be a person between them? No, that is definitely not possible. That means this story is not going to work for me, that A came at 8 a.m. and B came at 9 a.m. A could still come at 8 a.m. and maybe B I can push to 9 p.m. in the evening. If I do this, now there are slots in between. At least one person can definitely come in, maybe more also, because remember 10 and 11 both could be a.m. B and C and D could fit in here. Or one of them could come in the morning and one of them in the evening, or both of them could be after 9 p.m. in the night. I do not know that right now, nor should I worry about it, because I know it will get sorted with the other rule. But is this the only possibility? No, not really. I could also have a situation where B comes at 9 a.m. in the morning and A comes at 8 p.m. in the evening. This much effort you have to put, you'll have to think this one step by yourself, right? There is no shortcut solution, extra help available. You will have to consider, yes. And that is part of that detailed thinking, observe. I mean, once you're engaged, there still not be too much of a problem anyway. So this could be another story, and again, there could be at least one or more people in the middle, maybe some people afterwards also, put an or in between. So I read a rule and it gave me these two possible scenarios. Also notice it ruled out that A at 8 a.m. and B at 9 a.m. scenario. That was ruled out. So I read a rule, something got eliminated and some possibilities exist. The next rule was Alma did not visit Edna before both Cleo and Dina. Alma did not visit Edna before both Cleo and Dina. That means she's not the first person. One of Cleo and Dina has to be before Alma. Once I look at this information and digest it, I know this scenario is definitely ruled out. Why? Because in this scenario, Alma comes before anybody and everybody else. That means she will also come before Cleo and Dina, and that means it's not going to work for me because I have to keep the rule in mind. And again, repeating the idea, this keeping the rule in mind, eliminating scenario is the heart of your logical reasoning universe. Once you understand this, you may not even need to practice a lot and you can go straight away into the exam because you know this is the tool that is required. Practice is required for exposure and confidence building in this subject. But the idea, a lot of people actually will go unprepared and still do very, very well because they understand this game. So I will eliminate this. That means now I'm focused on this particular story, B at 9 a.m. in the morning and A at 8 p.m. That much I have fixed already. Cleo did not visit Edna between Bess and Dina. Cleo should not be between Bess and Dina. But this is not the only way. Cleo should not be between Bess and Dina. Not only that, there could be more people in between for all I know. But she should not be in the middle of Bess and Dina in the story, anywhere Bess and Dina might be, right? So, okay, let me think of this rule. And again, let me look at the information available. Say if I put C at 10 a.m. No matter where I put Dina, whether at 11 a.m. or later at 11 p.m., in both the cases, C is going to be between Bess and Dina. That tells me that this scenario is not going to work for me. And my deduction, this is your basic unit, is that C is going to come at 10 p.m. according to this story. Now for a second, think of Dina. If she comes at 11 p.m., if she comes in the slot after C, once again C will be between B and D. You do not want that to happen. That means D cannot come at 11 p.m. That means somewhere D will have to come at 11 a.m. And we are done with the story. We have resolved the issue. And the question was, who visited Edna? And I should be able to say with certainty that Cleo visiting at 10 p.m. is the last person. Right? So we got the answer. Answer was not very important. The process that there is a rule. The rule helps us eliminate and create possibilities. And once again, the last rule and more rules put together will further narrow down the possibility till you're left with one answer. In the case of exam, you still might be left with a few answers and you might have to choose the best possible answer according to the questions. So that is the exam level extra difficulty expected from a top exam. But what is the concept or what is the tool that we are using? Deductive reasoning, follow the rules, that's about it. Hello and welcome back to another LR reasoning foundation kind of a session. We'll work with a very basic puzzle and our agenda once again will be to notice the process that is being used to work out the problem. And in this case, it is a good opportunity or a reminder to work on your basic syllogisms and if and then conditions. There are separate detailed videos available for that. So please go through that in case you're not clear with the idea. I will straight away start with a very basic summary of the rule and then get into the problem. The problem can be done without thinking too much about the if-then rule, but think of it as a reminder to revise this particular idea because it can come in fairly handy. So let me start with the puzzle and then let me start with the basic if-then rule reminder that if I have a story like this, if X, then Y, the only logical conclusions and connections I can make is if I know X to be true, Y will be true, and if I know Y is not true, then I will also know X is not true. The in-between story is that if X is not true, can I say anything about the Y? Answer should be no. If Why is happening? Can I say anything about the X? Answer should once again be don't know. So this is your summary of the work that we have done in if-then conditionals and in syllogism. If you can use it, it would be great. But otherwise, in case this is a problem and going back and forth is an issue, the problem can also be approached more verbally and commonsensically. And this is common sense only anyway, right? So now let me get into the problem. The problem was my house number. It was also posted on the community tab. Most people did get it right. My house number, a puzzle. If my house number is a multiple of 3, then it is a number from 50 through 59. Now, as of now, I do not know whether it's a multiple of 3 or not. So let me start and assume for a second that it is a multiple of 3 and try and create a story from there and then see which scenarios work and how rules work together to eliminate some possibilities. So if the house number is a multiple of 3, that means 3A, 3, 6, 9, 0 or whatever, right? Then it is given that the house number is definitely from 50 to 59. And I'm saying it is a multiple of 3. So that means not only 50 to 59, 51, 54 and 57 only, which are the multiples of 3. So this itself told you that from 50 to 59, you can only think of 51, 54 and 57 if you want to. The next rule said, if my house number is not a multiple of 4, now I'm working with this particular case in mind. I'm assuming for a second that it is a multiple of 3. Therefore, the house number has to be between these 3. If X, then Y, I'm simply following that. But if my house number is one of these, that means it is not a multiple of 4. The story said, if not a multiple of 4, right? However you want to capture this information, then the house number has to be between 60 to 69. These are not multiples of 4. That means this is true. If X is true, then Y also has to be true. That means the house number has to be from 60 to 69. So this tells me that if I work with this story and I follow this story, I end up with my house number 60 to 69. But I assume that my house numbers were 51, 54 and 57. So this is not going to work for me. And maybe let me now think, okay, maybe this is my scenario. That means my house number is not a multiple of 4. And if I assume this scenario to be true, this will become false. This will not be true anymore. How can the house be in 60 to 69 and then be in 51, 54 or 57? So this will not be true. That means Y is not true. Therefore, X is not true. You can make this sense. I mean, you can make this conclusion without this formal structure also. I hope you're able to do that. But in case not, this can tell you very digitally and clearly. That means my house is not a multiple of 3. When I'm considering this scenario that it is not a multiple of 4, that means the house number is between 60 to 69 so far. The third rule said, if my house number is not a multiple of 6, if my house number is not a multiple of 6, then the house number is between 70 to 79. Okay. Now look at this. You already said it is not a multiple of 3. Keeping this in mind, you said it is not a multiple of 3. If it is not a multiple of 3, that also tells you that it is not a multiple of 6. This symbol means 6 and 6A multiple, right? If it is not a multiple of 6, that means the house number has to be between 70 and 79. But again, my story said the house number is between 60 to 69. But this is definitely true. So this will also be definitively true. Because you started with this story, you said this is false. If this is false, this is true. And if this is true, the house number is going to be between 70 to 79. That tells you that this is false. This is not going to work for me anymore. And if this is not going to work for me, I mean, again, not Y is true. That means this will also become false. This said not a multiple of 4. That means it is a multiple of 4. That means my house number has to be between 70 and 79. And the only multiple of 4 and not a multiple of 3 and not a multiple of 6 is going to be 76. So we got the answer finally. This is not the only way of going through with the story. You could have said multiple of 3, house number this, but this is not working, so not a multiple of 3. If not a multiple of 3, that means not a multiple of 6. That means the house number is here. And if the house number is here, the house number is not here. And therefore, it is not a multiple of 4, etc. I hope I'm not complicating the process too much, but a super fun puzzle to work out and a reminder to master these rules just in case. These kind of questions are out of fashion in CAT. They still appear in other exams and still are of great value to learn and master. They also help you with basic RC, critical thinking, etc. So do work on this. And a very simple application and a very simple puzzle. Again, a reminder which could have been done without it also, just by plugging in values, playing with the values. And remember, you're going back and forth. You start here, you go here, then you go back, and then you go here and you say, this is true and this is not true. So some kind of back and forth is happening. So might be a little bit of a challenge, but I hope not too much. So this is it for this mini session, part of that LR foundation building. I will see you really soon with more basic puzzles, etc. And log into your course and go through all those big problems also, because even those big problems have been simplified, have been done at a step by step, very micro level, easy steps as such. So don't get stuck with the CAT label and avoid the problem. Get into it one set a day, try it for 15 days and you will see an immediate guaranteed improvement. That much I can tell you for sure. So doing is the important bit. So this is it for this session. See you soon.